Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining our Q4 Manufacturing Outlook webinar today. I'm Richard Austin, BDO's National Head of Manufacturing. Just as an intro, clearly it's been a turbulent 24 months for everyone in the UK and globally as well, and manufacturing's no exception to that. I think we've been, you know, buffeted by headwinds, tailwinds, crosswinds, other winds as well. And clearly, you know, the current Omicron variant is, it clearly has to play out as well. So there's more to come, more cross tail and headwinds to come for all of us. And obviously, you know, in terms of highs, the sector as a whole has made very strong progress over the last three quarters. And clearly there have been highs and lows during the survey's output over the last couple of years, but today we're delighted to be joined by Make UK's chief economist Seamus Nevin and the senior economist James Brougham as well. So welcome to both of you. They'll be providing an update on the state of where we are today, state of manufacturing, and sharing findings from our latest Make UK and BDO Manufacturing Outlook report. Following that, we're also joined by BDO's innovation taxes partner, Ross Northall, business tax director, Claire Hudson, and global employer services partner, Steve Talbot, who is based in the north of England as well. So Ross will be providing an update on the latest R&D tax relief changes and how they impact UK manufacturers. And then this will be followed by Steve, who will provide us an update and sharing thoughts on how manufacturers can manage rising wage costs, which I think is a big element that we're seeing just nationally at the moment. And then finally, Claire will be covering off the key corporate tax issues impacting the sector, especially in the post-Brexit environment. The presentations will be followed by a live Q&A. So please do submit any questions you have through the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen, and we'll pick these up at the end of the presentation. But with that, I will hand over to Seamus at Make UK. Seamus.
Thanks, Richard, and thanks everybody for joining. I'm just gonna give you a brief potted overview of the political headlines that are affecting our sector at the moment as the warm-up act for the main event, which will be given by James shortly. So I suppose the big news, or the biggest news story today, is that Boris Johnson is facing potentially the biggest backbench rebellion of his premiership when MPs vote on new COVID restrictions for England later. Around 70 Conservative MPs are expected to vote against plans to introduce mandatory COVID passes to enter large venues in response to the Omicron cases that are rising across the UK. And there's concern about the implications for civil liberties, but also and more pertinently about the economic impact of a return to working from home guidance on businesses at a crucial time of year for many firms. On top of the rebel MPs, it's reported that up to 10 ministerial aides could resign to vote against the controls, though the measures are still likely to pass thanks to support from the opposition benches, and in particular, Labour's Keir Starmer announced yesterday that his party would be supporting the motion. However, the scale of the threatened revolt underlines just how difficult Boris Johnson's position has become following a series of largely self-inflicted wounds in recent weeks, in particular his Christmas parties, the Owen Paterson affair, and the renovation of the Prime Minister's Downing Street flat. It could become even more precarious if the Conservatives are defeated in the North Shropshire by-election on Thursday, where the Liberal Democrats are hoping to overturn a Tory majority of almost 23,000 from the last general election. The controversy has nevertheless provided a temporary distraction from the news of Boris Johnson's and other cabinet ministers' Christmas parties last year when tier three restrictions were in place and there was a countrywide lockdown. That story threatened to bring down the Prime Minister's leadership, but speculation to that end has dissipated, at least for now, although Conservative MPs remain unhappy at falling Tory poll ratings. If at least 15% of Tory MPs, that's 54 MPs at present, write to the backbench 1922 committee, a vote of confidence in the party's leader will be triggered. Under previous rules, the letters required annual renewal, meaning that those submitted so far would have expired after Christmas, but they now remain on file unless withdrawn, making it more likely that a vote will be triggered at some point. We don't know how many letters have been submitted, but Johnson's approval ratings have fallen to a record low, and the Conservatives are up to 9 percentage points behind Labour in the polls. The Tory party has a long history and a taste for regicide, so it's unlikely to continue to back Johnson if these trends persist. And having ousted two prime ministers in recent history, Margaret Thatcher and Theresa May, and gone on to win the subsequent general elections, it will not be shy of removing Johnson before voters have the chance if the party deems it necessary or in their interest to do so. On a more pressing issue, on the more pressing issue of the COVID vote in Parliament, in the Commons yesterday, Health Secretary Savage Abbott said that the UK Health Security Agency estimated there were 200,000 infections a day at the moment, with the new Omicron strain accounting for about 20% of cases in England and set to become dominant in London within the next 24 hours. The health service in England has declared level 4 national incident, which means that the NHS centrally will now lead the response to the virus rather than local trusts setting their own course. And that will enable vaccine clinics to operate around the clock, while hospital trusts will be able to discharge some patients to hotels. And some scientists have warned that further measures will be required in the coming weeks if the service is not is to avoid being overwhelmed from the tidal wave of hospitalizations that they are anticipating. While the recent Plan B restrictions in England are unlikely to impact the day-to-day operations much, as manufacturing was one of the few key and essential industries allowed to remain open during previous lockdowns, the main concern for our industry and for manufacturers across the country is how these restrictions will impact workers being able to come into work in factories. It's much easier to work from home if you have an office job, but obviously manufacturing is somewhat different. The other big political news for businesses right now concerns the Northern Ireland Protocol. So on that, the British government appears to have dropped its demand that the role of the European Court of Justice, popularly known as the ECJ, will be removed from overseeing the post-Brexit trade deal with the EU. That has been the big stumbling block preventing progress in negotiations thus far. But Brexit Minister David Frost has stressed on a number of occasions that since the summer, the importance of addressing the role of the ECJ in the protocol. But in recent weeks, Lord Frost has toned down his rhetoric about unilaterally suspending parts of the protocol by triggering Article 16. And he has now removed a major stumbling block in the way of agreement by effectively taking the governance issue off the table. The British government's change of tone followed a threat from the US government that Washington would delay removing punitive 25% and 10% tariffs on UK steel and aluminium products, respectively, or aluminium, to use British English rather than American, unless the British government backed down on its threats to undermine the Northern Ireland Protocol. So those tariffs have created significant problems for UK manufacturers. And I think there will be increasing hope that the dispute between the UK and the EU can be resolved. And at least now the signs are looking more positive. In recent days, the Brexit Minister Lord Frost and Ireland's Foreign Minister Simon Coveney have both said that they hope there could be, and I'm quoting here, with worthwhile progress before the end of the month, although discussions on some issues important to UK manufacturers, such as the rules on sanitary and phytosanitary goods, which food and drink is the biggest manufacturing subsector in the UK, and inspections on goods for customs reasons, will likely continue. Those negotiations will continue into 2022. I'm at risk now of transgressing into a discussion about the economy, so I will leave it there for now and hand you over to my colleague, James, who will give you the overview of our new Manufacturing Outlook report. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Seamus. Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to take you through our fourth quarter findings. Now, fans of the series, if you've attended these webinars before, might recall that in the previous two quarters, we've been posting some record-breaking figures for particularly in output and orders within the sector during the what is turned out to be quite a giddy recovery, especially where orders are concerned. And it was certainly predicted last quarter by the industry that we would be in record-breaking territory again. That has not come to pass. And while the figures are still very high, a bit of a sobering moment as most metrics have a bit of a slowdown, and the key drags now within industry are being identified as those continued price pressures on the input side and access to labor and general skills issues there. But nonetheless, if it wasn't really for this turbulent period that we've seen over the past 2 years, the balance figures that we're posting at the minute that I'll show you in a moment, they're still very high by historical standards. And it's only really in contrast of the very inflated figures we've seen over the past year that now we say it's somewhat of a slowdown in that pace of growth, but the figures are still high in their own right. One thing we continue to see, and we've seen throughout most of the year, is that domestic orders are outpacing export orders, but it's important not to jump to conclusions at the moment about what that might mean for the future of trading, and indeed our biggest trading partner, the EU, and whether that's the Brexit, is, so to speak, is to blame, or really the broken and very backed up supply chain at the moment is causing a distortion in where companies are sourcing their inputs from. A major story, and perhaps the biggest concern for the industry that's been building over the past couple of quarters, but really coming to a head now as the industry realizes it's going to be sustained, is prices, input prices. And they've been increasing now for the fourth quarter in a row, and that's not expected to abate into 2022, really perhaps deep into the second half of 2022. Employment is growing. However, what's happening is that manufacturers are unable to fulfill the employment levels to what they would wish. So it, by historical standards, employment growth is strong. But what we also see in ONS data as well is that vacancies are very high. So the demand for labor is extremely high, and there's not enough supply in that labor market to satiate manufacturers' demand. Nonetheless, expectations are overall very positive for 2022. Perhaps not as positive as we've reported in previous quarters, as now these limiting factors are coming to more of a head. So our manufacturing forecast, our overall forecast for the year has been reduced slightly down to 6.9, and in the previous quarter it was estimated to be at 7.3. So it's not a very significant reduction, but a small reduction nonetheless. And our UK GDP growth forecast is at 7.2%. So what I'll do now is I'll go and talk into some of those metrics I'm talking about and what's been happening with them over the past quarter. Thank you very much. And we see here, if we look at the far right, the balance between output and orders, and we see that orders are still leading output, which is not entirely surprising, as it's fairly infamous now, and we've seen it last quarter as well, that demand is outstripping supply. This is particularly notable in some infamous subsectors, and indeed with certain inputs such as the supply of semiconductors, but it goes round to certain grades of steel, types of plastic, and even cardboard are seeing very heightened levels of demand that both the global and domestic industry is unable to fulfill at the rate of the orders coming in. And we see a slight decline in the overall levels there, those balance figures. But as I was mentioning earlier on, if you look at the far right, even in this 5-year time series we have on scale and for perspective, there's 30 years of this data. They're very high by historical standards, but it is a little bit of a slowdown. And as we'll get on to in a moment, manufacturers do expect that slowdown in the rate of growth to continue, but a very, very far way away from any sort of negative recession in these metrics. Next slide, please. So as I mentioned, that difference between the UK and export market, if we look, I suppose, most interestingly at the far right, and anywhere that's in a green box is the manufacturer's forecast. So that's not our analysis forecast. We ask as part of the survey, within the next 3 months on given metrics, what manufacturers expect to see. So it tends to be quite a good short-term insight into the future. We see the gap between export and UK orders narrowing somewhat, but have overall levels are within a margin of error staying similar, which is encouraging that we're not seeing a sort of off the top of the roller coaster, so to speak, where we've seen very, very inflated orders over the past couple of quarters. And it's important that doesn't drop off like a stone, especially for the consistency of cash flow within the UK manufacturing stock. Next slide, please. Here's a selection of subsectors. We track all subsectors, but these are just here some core ones we like to talk about. We see across the board, and it varies indeed, but more time than not, we're seeing orders outpace output, particularly in the case there you see is electrical equipment, which is very much so hampered by the infamous semiconductor shortage. We're actually seeing a slight reduction in our balance in terms of output, where orders are outpacing the ability for the companies within that subsector to fulfill that. But across the board, on average, as I mentioned, altogether, they make that high figures and high overall output and orders figures that we're seeing. Next slide, please. This slide shows where there is new demand, where that demand's coming from on a global scale. Often this can be used as a proxy for how foreign economies are doing, and especially over the past 2 years, we've seen some interesting changes about as COVID and the various national lockdowns across the globe swept east from west, and how those demand streams changed. If we look at the far right, the clustering of the far right here, this is typical. This is a typical hierarchy that we would see, which in other sense means it's a proxy for the global demand streams in terms of where that demand's coming from is back to some semblance of normality. dare I say such a thing, with Europe leading that demand, which is always the case, and then North America, and then closely followed by Asia. Interesting to note that over the past couple of quarters, we've seen for third place, Asia and the Middle East region trading blows in terms of giving more demand to UK manufacturing, but still they're within a few percentage points of each other. So it's only just Asia has pipped Middle Eastern demand this quarter around. And next slide, please. This is perhaps our most interesting graph, especially we've brought this, a new feature since the pandemic, to see, given the sort of sudden shock crises that we've seen, especially COVID, how the manufacturer's expectations match up to what actually comes to pass in a given quarter. So to quickly explain what might seem a little confusing at the start, if we look on the right, the dots imply what actually occurred in the quarter when we look in hindsight. And the bars represent what manufacturers expected to happen that quarter when they were asked 3 months prior. So what we see is, understandably, no one really saw the huge downturn coming at the start, around, you know, the start of 2020. But then what actually occurred is throughout, we see manufacturers consistently underestimated the speed of recovery. So we see where those dots are on the sort of last four groupings of bars there, they're significantly higher than what was expected. And now, as expectations have, as industry has learned and expectations have become more sober, we see now actually what happened in this quarter, which is the penultimate bar, so the bar just left of the green grouping, we see that expectations were not met. And that's the first time in the past year that we've seen that, that optimism in Q3 was a bit too high. And what happened in that between Q3 and Q4 was the rearing of the head of those continued input cost pressures and those labor shortages and limits on being able to actually deliver goods despite order books being very strong. And now finally, we see in the first quarter for next year, that forecast is now significantly reduced compared to the previous two quarters. Indeed, I just want to stress that it's still a very high balance of figure, historically speaking, but it's a certain reduction compared to the previous two quarters' expectations. Next slide, please. And to talk about the focus on the main issue, certainly on the lips of all manufacturers at the moment, is those price pressures. So that is expected to continue, both UK prices and export prices increasing. Margins, which is the blue lines there in the bottom, thinking about coming up to match, but certainly not matching the pace of the rise of those prices. Going forwards, what we expect to see is the producer price inflation at the latest data stands at 13% for the quarter. The newest data comes out tomorrow. It's likely to continue increasing. What we're hearing now in industry as well is that double digits, so you know, on average of 10% price rises business to business, is roundly expected. And in any previous time, that would have been back to the table with renegotiation and all sorts. And now that's flowing through industry up and down the supply chain. And so what that no doubt effect is going to have is that's continue to apply pressure to consumer inflation over the following year, as that internal business to business price rises run through the entire industry. Next slide, please. But despite this, confidence hasn't taken much of a dip. And I suppose in comparison, we've seen that the significant dip and a dip in expectations in terms of those output and orders. But overall, it's good performance, especially when we compare it to the previous 2 years when we were at the start of the pandemic, where manufacturers really saw record-breaking declines in their output and orders. So we're seeing an only moderate downturn in confidence, significantly above the inflection point of 5. So still very confident both in businesses' performance, which is the red line, and the overall UK economy's recovery. And next slide, please. And the other major story is employment. And now I think the green box has been offset for some reason. I think that's slipped out. But the red bars are employment and the orange line is for those investment intentions. I'll start with employment. What we've seen, and indeed what we'll see again, no doubt, is that green box and the bar that's sort of just next to the green box is the expectation for next quarter, or indeed manufacturers' intentions for employment. That will not be realized. It's what we've seen for the past three quarters, where that bar has actually been significantly higher than what the bar, the adjacent bar next to it, where manufacturers are baying for staff, but cannot find it in the market. And indeed, that's now reflected in the ONS vacancies data, which is the highest for the sector, which is approximately 3.4 vacancies per 100 jobs. And that number never really punches the parapet of 1.8. And that's been raising steadily over the past few months. And we expect on the next data release for that to continue rising. Quite why this is happening. There's a lot of features and reasons. We obviously have within certain subsectors that were dependent on European labor and now struggling to access that as easily, but also now a general society proclivity away from physical jobs is certainly contributing. And indeed with an aging skills gap within the industry, as retirements continue to occur amongst the pandemic, we see a loss of skilled engineers within the industry as well. To mention employment as well, we saw quite a positive uptick there in the third quarter of the year. But now in the fourth quarter, it's dropped down a little bit. And that's interesting, that's occurred, especially when during this period, we had the Chancellor's announcement of the extension to the capital investment allowances. And that's along with the coexisting super deduction. Not really cause for concern yet, this minor drop in positivity, because it's still positive in its own right. The question is in the coming year, whether that positivity is going to be hampered by the need for manufacturers now to prioritize the cash they hold on the costs and the rising cost pressures in the coming year, and whether as a result, investment is deprioritized. Next slide, please. And then finally, we have here those charts I mentioned at the start, which are our forecast for the manufacturing sector. So indeed, a minor revision down from approximately 7.3% growth for this year, down to 6.9%, similar for UK GDP, slightly downgraded to 7.2%. And then for the next year, a more moderate 3.3% increase, with the UK economy outpacing it approximately twice the pace, which is to be normal and is expected. That's not necessarily a bad omen. We would typically expect on our future forecast for the manufacturing output growth to be approximately half of that, the overall UK GDP. And then the very final slide, please, which is just the overview. So if I sum it up in two takeaways after all this confusing soliloquy by me, the main pressures at the moment are continued cost pressures. It was not expected. It was expected that by now in Q4, in the middle of the year, that they would have abated. Now manufacturers are hunkering down. For that to continue right the way through 2022. As a result, cost inflation internally on the supply side is going through the roof, and we're not yet seeing that fully affect the consumer market, but no doubt it will start to continue to trickle down through into that throughout the coming year. And then the second key drag is getting the staff, and why staff is in so in demand, because order books are very, very strong, and the biggest challenge manufacturers are facing is being able to deliver on those orders. And obviously inherent risks there include the risk of overtrading and pitfalls of the like. So thank you very much. And I'll hand you over to Ross at BDO now.
Thanks, James. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ross Northall. I'm a partner of BDO. I specialise in R&D tax relief. So I'm going to talk to you briefly today. Just a little bit around the current climate of research development tax relief with HMRC and some of the recent changes that we've either experienced or have been announced. So just as a little bit of background as to the context as to where we are in the R&D climate at the moment. I think from a government perspective, R&D continues to be something that the government are strongly pushing. It's something that they see as being key to the future economy of the UK. But at the same time, what we have, whilst we might have that big carrot dangling from the government, we have HMRC currently waving a large stick around. I think that the background to this is in their most recent audit, it was identified that it's forecast that around £300 million of expenditure was given or cash was given away by HMRC incorrectly, either due to incorrect R&D claims or fraudulent R&D claims between the period of 2013 and 2016. So as a result of that, HMRC now have really stepped up their efforts to make sure that businesses are claiming their R&D claims correctly. We've got 100 more inspectors in the R&D units, and the level of activity that we're seeing from HMRC has really increased. So I'll just get the next slide, please. So I thought what might be useful, I'm not going to go into any great detail, just to set the scene, just to talk around what is a eligible R&D for the purposes of the R&D scheme. So what we're looking for is three real criteria, which I always think you guys should have in the back of your mind when you're considering R&D in your businesses. So the first one is a systematic approach, which means that you're going through an iterative process in order to achieve something. So that is to have a project, which I think most businesses, particularly in the manufacturing sector, would always be able to tick. And then the next two criteria are the key ones, and these go hand in hand. So what we're looking for is some scientific or technological uncertainty and an advancement in your scientific or technological knowledge. This bit here is the key to any successful R&D claim is that you have technical problems and uncertainties that you need to overcome. And in going through the process of overcoming those, you are learning something new of a scientific or technological nature. And I think that just as a bit of context, it's just important to always keep that in the back of your mind when we're talking about R&D. Can I get the next slide, please? And then on this slide, I just wanted to just remind you the reasons why we're doing this. The benefits to companies are still large. We have two schemes. We have the SME scheme for say smaller businesses, but it's businesses with typically less than 500 employees. So if you're a profitable company, that equates to 25% of whatever your qualifying spend is in R&D being your cash benefit. And then if you're a large company, you claim under the RDEC scheme, and that equates to 13%. And then due to the way that the calculations work, if you're loss-making, that can actually increase from an SME to 33% and reduce slightly under the RDEC scheme to just over 10%. Can I get the next slide, please? So as I said, we've seen a marked increase in HMRC activity, and I suppose what I just wanted to update you on today is a couple of those ones which could be pertinent to yourselves and also I think setting the scene for the direction of R&D for the next few years in this country. So we've had a couple of tax type tribunal cases recently which we've seen in the courts. So the first one was Haiti Industries. So this was a manufacturing business, and this HMRC inquiry and ultimate tribunal looked into four key areas of that company's R&D claim. So the first thing that is addressing it is the definition of what a project would be. And it also looked at whether those projects qualified for R&D tax relief. But then it then went on to look at subcontracted expenditure and whose R&D it is, and also subsidized expenditure, so where a customer is paying somebody for either a product or some R&D and the implications of that into the R&D claim. This was a lengthy inquiry and it raised a whole host of matters, but I suppose what I just want to pull out for you guys to just think about is the importance of making sure that when you submit an R&D claim, there is a record of or some form of documentary evidence as to what work was undertaken and details of any plans or scheme of work that was undertaken in relation to that R&D claim, because if it does end up in inquiry, that is becoming, it's always been of importance, but it is being brought more and more to the fore. And then the next point around subcontracted R&D. So this is where you would use specialist resource for an element of the R&D claim. And in understanding where R&D is subcontracted or not, the tribunal found four key points that you have to consider. So the first one is around IP and who holds the IP. The next one is the financial risks and rewards of undertaking that work. So who is taking the financial risk of that work? Any autonomy that the subcontractors have in doing that work? And then also, are the deliverables and milestones and typically that they would be then linked to the contract value? So those four areas, every time that you enter into a contract with somebody, it's those four areas that need to be considered from an R&D perspective, because depending on how you would look at those four areas would depend on whether your R&D is subcontracted or not. And then the final point is around subsidised R&D. Subsidised R&D is when expenditure is I suppose, met directly or indirectly by a person other than the company that's doing the R&D. So typically within the manufacturing sector, that might be where you have a bespoke product that a client is paying for. It could be a one-off or a first-of-class product. And depending on the nature in which that contract is structured, that R&D could be subsidised. So if they are directly paying for that R&D activity, then that could be deemed subsidised. And what that would mean is if you was an SME, you'd end up having to claim under the large company scheme. So this was another area that was looked at in this case. But it was also looked at in the Quinn case in further detail. So Quinn was actually a construction company, which was taken to tribunal by HMRC contesting their SME status due to the fact that they were paid by customers for their R&D work. So the company defended their SME status on the basis that the R&D activities weren't directly linked to the payment, but they were ultimately paid on being successful. And the judge in coming to his verdict on this, I'll quote him because I think it is quite important, said it would be wholly out of kilter with the overall SME scheme if an SME were deemed to be denied relief solely because it seeks to recover some or all of the relevant cost under its commercial contracts with clients. So I think that was a really strong verdict there from the judge, that where he is defending the fact that if you ever were in a situation where you could commercially gain from your R&D activities, you would never be able to claim under the SME scheme under the way that HMRC have interpreted those rules. This later case, this Quinn case, is quite an, I think it is an important one, because off the back of this, we have seen HMRC still standing on the same position on their guidance and actually updating their guidance. And the area of subsidised expenditure, I think, is going to become quite an issue for a number of businesses. So where you are being paid for your R&D activities, I think this is an area where you really do need to put a lot of focus in, because it is an area where HMRC are going to be active and looking at your contractual relationship and deciding whether you can claim under the SME scheme or not. Because we can't see this issue going away with HMRC. It's something that they are really focused on. And we know that from talking to other providers at HMRC, have got a number of similar tax cases open at the moment under this subsidised point. So it's something that they are still forcing through. Just on the flip side, so we've also had a couple of consultations over the last 12 months. So July 20, we had a consultation purely into allowable costs, and then March 21, we then had a full consultation which looked at pretty much every aspect of R&D. Can I get the next slide, please? So we've had these two consultations, and then in the most recent budget, off the back of those consultations, we've had some announcements to changes which will come through from 1st of April 2023. So the first change to be announced is that cloud and data costs will be an allowable expenditure from 1st of April 23, which I think is quite a welcome thing. It was no great surprise when it was brought in. This is HMRC bringing the R&D scheme up to date for the modern way that R&D is done. The scheme was brought in just over 20 years ago now. And in that time, the way that people use data and the cloud becoming more and more pertinent in R&D activities has increased, and the cost of you doing that for R&D has increased. So it's a sensible addition. You can now claim those costs. And then the other point that they've announced, which I think any business that's got either a multinational aspect to them or is operating internationally will need to take this point on board, is that from 1st of April 23, your subcontractor costs are going to be limited to those subcontractors located in the UK. So this is HMRC bringing our R&D scheme in line with most of the jurisdictions, where at the moment, if the cost sits in a UK company, you can claim that cost as an R&D cost regardless of where that R&D is located. But from April 23, you will only be able to claim those costs if that R&D activity is actually done on British soil. So when this was announced, the estimates were that they think up to half of the qualifying costs claimed by companies at the moment could be done overseas. So this could have quite large ramifications for businesses. And if you do think this could be impacting you, I think you need to start looking at this now to decide whether you're going to accept that your R&D claims will decrease as a result of this, or whether you're going to be changing your structures and how you do your R&D in order to continue to claim R&D in the UK. And if you are considering that, then that could have wider implications for other taxes as well. So I think businesses are going to have to give really careful consideration to this, to these new rules as they come in, because if you are operating overseas, and many businesses do parts of R&D activities overseas, then it's going to have a real big impact on your R&D claim. And one final point is we do also have a PAYE cap that's been brought in from April this year now, which has been well spoken about before, so I don't plan to go into any great details, but just to be aware that it is there and it could potentially impact your claims in the future. Can we get the next slide, please? So I think we've got questions at the end. So now I'll hand over to Steve, and I'll let you go ahead, Steve.
Cheers, thanks, Ross. Afternoon, everybody. So I'm Steve Talbot. I'm a partner that looks after the north of England, specialising in employees and everything to do with them. So their pay, their reward, their benefits, etc. And if you just go on to the next slide, and one of the things that I just wanted to talk about today very briefly was how can we manage the rising wage costs? One thing is there's no magic wand, unfortunately. So anyone that thought I was going to give you a magic wand, that's not going to happen. But just that there are some sensible things that businesses can look after. So if we look at the downside, so what's causing the wages costs to go up? Well, HMRC kindly introduced the health and social care levy, which is essentially an increase of 1.25%. You know, the best way to think about it is just think about it as national insurance for now, but essentially it will become a separate levy, very similar to the app levy. The one quirk to think about on the health and social care levy is that this will apply to people of state pension age as well. So if you've got people in your business that are state pension age and continue to work, they currently wouldn't have any NIC, but now they will have some NIC. Well, sorry, they'll have some health and social care levy. National minimum wage, another favourite topic of mine, is increasing again from April. So across the range of rates increases, you'll see an increase of anywhere from 4% to 11%. 11% is for one of the apprenticeship rates, which I'm sure a lot of the businesses on the call will have. And I'll come back to NMW in a couple of slides. CJRS, we've seen a lot of businesses having to repay some of the money they took. So again, increasing the cost of employment. There's on the session today, we've seen skills gap. We've seen that there's, you know, people are recruiting. You know, if there's not a big pool of people to pick from, will that pool of people ultimately cost more? Because they can demand a higher price. So therefore, if it's going to cost more, what can you do to try and offset some of those costs? And also, again, massive changes in the employment tax arena. So the IR35 changes, which came into the public sector, the private sector, has had a significant impact on businesses and how they do this. HMRC are looking at that area and they are finding businesses have got it wrong. So when you get it wrong from an HMRC perspective, there's always that wonderful thing called a penalty. And NMW carries a 200% penalty, CJRS, 100% penalty, getting IR, things like IR35 wrong, all based on taxpayer behaviour. So it depends on how you behave, depends on how much penalty you get. But all of these things take money out of your business and give it somewhere else. So what can you do to try and drive these costs down? Well, again, like I said, there's no magic wand to wave, unfortunately. If I had that, I'd certainly be waving it. But you can look to maximise employee benefit packages. And I'll cover what that can mean in a couple of slides' time. So it's using things that are already there that you may or may not be currently providing to try and reduce the cost. And the ultimate, the way I like to look at it is how can I reduce cost, not headcount? Because I don't want to reduce headcount. I want to grow. But therefore, how do I maximise what I'm currently paying and how I can do this? And the other thing as well is from an employment tax perspective, prevention is always better than the cure. So if you can have policies, procedures in place to prevent things happening like HMRC coming and knocking on your door and getting penalties, that's much better than ending up having to pay the same amount plus a penalty. So always think about what are your policies, what are your procedures, what should you be doing? So the next slide, this one just briefly shows you what the health and social care levy is going to do. So currently, you've seen the current rates, very simple. The rates are going to increase for 22-23 because they haven't got time to make it a proper separate levy. But then from 23-24, it will be a separate levy across the board. But the numbers are all the same. It's just how they're going to do that and how your payroll systems will function. Just go on to the next slide. This just shows you how the impact of the health and social care levy will be. So if you've got an average salary of 30k, you're going to be paying more than £255 a person more just because of this health and social care levy. And obviously, if you extrapolate that across your business, can make quite a big figure, eat into margins, and make the cost of employment even more. So I'll save the best slide to last. So if you just go on to the next slide for me, we'll talk about NMW and CJRS first before I give you some other things you can do. So from a minimum wage perspective, HMRC love minimum wage because people get it wrong. And basically, if you get it wrong, you can get up to a 200% penalty. They're also really kind to HMRC because what they do is when you get it wrong, they tell your friends and family. They publish it in the papers and online to tell everybody that these businesses have been named and shamed. And quite often, the actual amount of naming and shaming, the actual cash cost, can be less than 20 grand, can be less than £10,000. But you still get named and shamed. Now, recently, there were over 200 employees recently named and shamed. But luckily, there's under 5% of those named and shamed were from the manufacturing sector. Now, you can read that two ways because stats are brilliant. You can read that in one way and say, that's fantastic. Only 5% of manufacturers are getting it wrong. Therefore, it's brilliant. Or you could read it the other way and say HMRC just haven't been focused on the manufacturing sector yet, and that's to come. So you can read it either way. But what are the issues? What are people getting caught out on? Well, the majority of people are getting things wrong where they're deducting amounts from people's pay. So that can be things like dress code. It can be things like Christmas parties. It can be things like being really helpful. So if you've got If you manufacture widgets and someone buys a widget from you and you deduct that from their pay, that widget, that payment for that widget could reduce minimum wage purposes. So 99% of the time, what I see is in that area there, people don't know they're getting it wrong. They're trying to do right for their employees. And it just so happened the way the rules are written, they end up getting it wrong. A third of people are not paying enough in terms of working time. So that includes trial shifts, travel time, mandatory training. You know, if you insist people get there 15 minutes before their shift starts, that's working time. If you expect people to, you know, quite often what they'll see is they'll say, oh, you've got to clock in, or you've got to walk the length of the factory to clock in. So that might only be take 30 seconds, a minute or whatever. But again, HMRC are very pedantic in this area and they say that's working time. And therefore, if someone's got to walk that minute every single day, of every week, of every month, of every year, all of a sudden it adds up to a failure. 16% are not getting it right when it comes to apprentices, failing to pay the right rates. There are special rules around apprenticeships, so you've got to be careful. And 11% are just getting the rate wrong. So again, think back to policies, think back to procedures. When there's a change in NMW rates, when people have a birthday, etc., do you have a method of being able to capture that and getting the rate right? If not, again, you could be at risk here. CJRS. So CJRS, the furlough scheme, was a great scheme, kept people in being able to have cash. It's obviously now ended, but HMRC are now, you know, as always, they're looking at things in more detail. They're trying to put the onus back on you as the employer to make sure you got things right. Everyone I talk to goes, yes, we got it right. But everyone, we then look at the records. No, they haven't. They've got it wrong. HMRC expect nearly that all claims will have at least a 10% error rate. So the simple thing is, did you do a claim? Have you made an error? Do you know you've made an error? quite often, if you're reviewing your own work, it's very hard to find an error. So that's the doom and gloom over, you'll be pleased to hear. And then the final slide will just go into what things you can do to reduce cost, not headcount. So the simple thing is smart pensions, another name for salary sacrifice for pensions. Most people will think, oh, do you know what, everyone's got that. They haven't. Lots and lots of businesses we speak to haven't got that. And the simple thing is, a lot of people think this is a pension, you know, a pension provider thing. It's not. It's got nothing to do with the pension provider. It's just how you put the money into the pension scheme. And therefore, it's got a payroll, an employee, a legal impact, and an NMW impact. So you've got to make sure you get it right. And the simple message here is, for every £1 million of qualifying wages cost you've got, you could save 7.7K as a company every year without fail. So if you haven't got it, and you've got people paid above minimum wage, you should definitely consider putting it in. Electric cars. So this is massive on two fronts. One, for people's ESG agendas. And secondly, there's significant savings when you compare it to normal cars. Savings for the employer and the employee. And quite often, if you structure it correctly, the employer can take some of the employee's savings. So again, electric cars are fantastic things to be looking at. There's other exemptions that you can look at just to try and make your packages more effective. So annual events. You'll have seen, obviously, everyone will know the annual events being the Christmas party exemption, but there's a couple of qualifying criteria. It's got to be less than £150 and everybody's got to be invited. So if you consider Boris's get-together, would that qualify? Well, was everybody invited? However, if it was a business meeting and therefore wine and cheese was just provided at a business meeting, it wouldn't feature in the annual events, it would feature elsewhere. And again, it could be taxable, it could be tax-free. But was it a party? Who knows? So you've also then got to think about, well, actually, how can I use that annual event? You know, what do I do for my staff? Do I have one? Do I have two? How do I make the most of it? Trivial benefits. So trivial benefits are things that are less than £50 in value, not cash, not linked to employment, given at Christmas, birthdays, etc. Do I currently give my staff something that's taxable, and could I replace it with something that's tax-free? And in-house benefits. So if I manufacture something that's usable and is usable for my employees and sell it, can I sell it to my employees cheaper and basically both make a saving? Absolutely, we can. Other things to basically look at is the correct NIC letter. Lots of businesses get employees on the wrong NIC letter. And given that employees are going to cost more, it's a simple check to go through your payroll and make sure that people are on the correct NI category letter, apprenticeships especially. Final things to make sure that we are not going to pay more than we need to: make sure your processes and policies are up to date. Very keen, if you've had changes in terms of how people work, where they work from, and what they do, your policies and procedures still capture those situations? Because if HMRC came and knocked on the door tomorrow, okay, you might have a little bit of tax to pay, but would you have penalties to pay? Can you reduce the amount of penalties you pay by getting it right now? So therefore, there's a number of things you can do around your employees, around your workforce, to make sure you stay on the right side of where HMRC wants you to do. That's all I've got to say on that for now. And I'm going to pass over to Claire.
Thanks, Steve. Hi, everyone. I'm Claire Hudson. I'm a director in business tax in the BDO Midlands office. So today we're going to focus in on one particular trend that we've seen from manufacturers in this post-Brexit environment, and that is expanding their presence overseas. So before we go into any specific detail, we're just going to reflect for a moment on what the current environment looks like. So from everything we've heard today, it's a difficult general environment before we even think about tax. So rising costs in terms of raw materials, labour shortages, rising costs of employing staff, supply chain issues, amongst other things. And on top of that, the corporation tax environment is going to become that a bit more punishing in around 15 months' time. So from the 1st of April 23, the corporation tax rate is set to rise to 25% from the current 19%. At the same time as that change happens, the annual investment allowance is going to revert back to 200K from the £1 million that it stands at the moment. the capital allowances super deduction that gives an extra 30% uplift is going to come to an end at the same time. And as Ross was referring to earlier, there are going to be some restrictions on overseas R&D costs that are also coming in at that time. And so whilst certainly expansion overseas is a trend that we've seen post-Brexit because of, in particular, businesses wanting to have a presence in an overseas territory, often to maintain a customer relationship, the increase in corporate taxes and reductions in relief that are coming in the UK might see a continuation of that trend for a little bit longer, particularly where overseas lower tax territories, so for example, Ireland, are being considered. I think it's also important, though, just to have at the back of our minds that whilst there are some, let's say, short-term pressures that are going to arise in corporation tax generally, in the longer term, being free from the EU and hopefully with some of the economic pressures arising from the pandemic reducing a little, it is entirely possible that the government may eventually seek to go the other way with corporation tax and make us ultimately a lower tax territory to try and attract longer term investment. So it may well be the case that at some point in the future there is a little bit less doom and gloom. So in the next couple of slides, we're just going to focus in on some of the corporation tax issues that businesses should consider if they're looking to expand either into Europe or a little bit further afield. So if we start then with Europe, a very, very simple setup. Frequently receive calls where a manufacturing business, you know, says we need to set up a subsidiary in, let's say, Germany to maintain a client contract there. Can you put us in touch with BDO Germany to get something incorporated? And whilst obviously the simple answer is always yes, often we find that the broader corporation tax sort of picture isn't well considered by businesses. So we're just going to run through briefly some of the things that you may need to think about. The first of those issues is withholding tax. So post-Brexit, with us no longer being part of the EC Interest and Royalties Directive and the EC Parent and Subsidiary Directive, we have to think about, when we look into the future and thinking about repatriating funds potentially from the overseas subsidiary, we have to think about the tax treaty that's in existence between the UK and that country. And some territories, Germany is a good example, do not have a 0% rate in the treaty that would have been the case in a pre-Brexit environment. So there's a potential cost and some administration to consider there. Another key point is often residence, particularly where the point of setting up the subsidiary might not be for sort of genuine expansion. It might be to, say, maintain a contract and just have local presence that a large customer requires. Often we find that the intention of the UK group is really to run that subsidiary from the UK. So potentially there might be no local board meetings might be held in the UK, strategic decisions might be made in the UK. And what that might give us is a residency issue whereby the UK also views the overseas entity as tax residents in the UK. Dual residence can be a complex issue to resolve, particularly because it requires mutual agreement between two different tax authorities. So a situation to avoid if possible. Conversely, some territories in Europe will require a local director in order for incorporation to proceed. And there are also often substance requirements locally, and Ireland in particular is a territory that where the substance requirements locally are increasing, as they are very aware that you know, many groups are looking to sort of set up subsidiaries there to take advantage of lower corporation tax rates. One additional thing, and a quite complex area to consider, is transfer pricing. So if goods are going to be moving from the UK parent to the European subsidiary, is your pricing appropriate in terms of those goods flows? Should costs be recharged for central functions from the UK to the overseas subsidiary? And if so, does a markup need to be applied? Transfer pricing documentation is also something that needs to be considered depending on the size of the group. And we have come across situations where businesses have set up overseas subsidiaries. Actually, it's proceeded beyond the initial sort of reason for setup, perhaps to maintain a contract, and a local sales director has been appointed. If that obviously positive scenario should happen, just need to be aware of permanent establishment risk if the local sales team are mobile and sort of traveling around Europe and negotiating contracts in other territories. With Europe, particular attention needs to be paid to the DAC 6 or mandatory disclosure rules, which can require certain cross-border transactions, often ones that are seemingly innocuous, to be reported. So, for example, the transfer of potentially part of a production line or the transfer of IP cross-border, amongst other things, could need to be reported. And we'll also need to think about the UK control foreign company regime. Not usually a massive issue if there is genuine substance in the overseas subsidiary, and not particularly a big issue for a lot of European territories, which are often on our excluded territories list. But it's something that you may need to think about from a compliance perspective at some point, depending on the territory of incorporation. And one final thing to consider would be green taxes. So here in the UK, we've got plastic packaging tax coming in from April 2022. UK isn't the only territory in Europe that's pressing ahead with green taxes. So it's worth looking at what the current plans are in the territory that you are potentially expanding to. One potential alternative to a subsidiary is setting up an overseas branch in the European territory. And that would give you the potential to elect out of the UK tax regime altogether, which could simplify things vastly. But whether that's a viable option really depends on the reason for you setting up overseas. If it's genuine expansion, it might be something to consider as a first step. If instead you are looking to set up overseas for a particular existing trading arrangement or to meet the requirements of a customer, then perhaps a branch wouldn't do the trick. And finally, just to consider some of the additional complexities that may arise if a manufacturing group were to consider expanding outside of Europe, going back to transfer pricing, often there are certain territories outside of Europe that can be very rigorous in terms of their transfer pricing regimes. We in the UK have a de minimis threshold, and smaller companies aren't within the scope of the regime. However, not all overseas jurisdictions operate in the same way, and their documentation requirements can be particularly onerous. So Canada, USA, Australia in particular. So something worth thinking about before you press ahead with incorporating. Another thing to consider would be additional clauses in tax treaties. Some treaties enable the overseas territory to deduct withholding tax on technical or consultancy fees with a very broad definition. That's something we see very frequently with African expansion. And it's just something to be aware of, as it can result in additional costs that may not always be able to be passed on to the end customers. Some territories require local ownership to an extent, so it might not be possible to have 100% UK ownership. You might have to consider a JV arrangement with a local entity, or at least the presence of a local director. And outside of Europe, there is an increased likelihood as well in tax treaties of dividend withholding taxes being suffered. And the key point with dividend withholding taxes is that if the dividend is not taxable in the UK, which the majority of dividends from corporates aren't, then there would be no relief for any withholding tax suffered in the UK either. Hybrid mismatch rules are something else to be aware of, particularly if there's any kind of mismatch with payments made from the UK to the overseas entity that are not taxed in the overseas entity, a very complex set of rules that definitely require specialist advice. One other thing to watch out for would be the legal form of the overseas entity. So thinking longer term, at some point in the future, if you were to divest of the overseas subsidiary, there's a beneficial relief in the UK called the substantial shareholding exemption. That rests on a number of conditions, but also there being ordinary share capital in the subsidiary. And depending on the legal form of the overseas entity, sometimes they're not viewed as having share capital. So that's a point to be aware of and something to consider up front. And finally, just a small point to consider. If you are effectively exploring the overseas territory before you press ahead with incorporation and potentially, let's say, operating a contract beforehand, then permanent establishment, again, something worth considering, because certain territories can deem there to be a permanent establishment in so with a very low sort of threshold. So India is one example where just purely performing services in the territory for a certain number of days can cause you to pass that threshold. So I think in summary, lots and lots of issues to consider, either whether you're expanding into Europe or further afield. And it's certainly worth giving the full corporation tax spectrum some sort of thought before going ahead. I'm going to hand over now for the Q&A. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you, Claire. We've had three questions come through and I'm quite conscious of time. So if we can work through those, that would be great. So the first question to Seamus and James at Make UK. In your simulations, how long does the period of relatively high inflation above 4% last for?
So to give a simple answer, probably around the gap between Q2 and Q3 next year. The reason being, tomorrow we're very unlikely to see the MPC meet and raise interest rates. That's largely expected to not happen. They probably will at a coming meeting in the new year. And combined with that, we'll have the downward pressure, indeed the upward pressure on the CPI next year, coming from what we mentioned in our presentation from the supply side of the industry, experiencing very, very high prices that is no doubt going to apply pressure on the consumer side. We do expect generally a bit of abation in that in the second half of next year. And that's why we expect to see it go up, inflation to continue to rise a little bit in the first quarter of next year. But then by the between Q2 and Q3, expect it to cool off below that 4% level.
Thanks, James. And the next question, what are the trends in the number of businesses facing distress and liquidation? Have you got any insights around that?
Yeah, we do actually. The bits of data we have around that 46% of manufacturers that have taken out some form of CBIL support are currently rated at a more level. 46% are more likely to be a high or above average high level of corporate insolvency. And also from a previous bit of research we've done is that a third of the industry is concerned that over the next 2 years that their debt and or tax liabilities will pose an operational threat to the business. And as a result, we can see, and also we're hearing on the ground anecdotally, that insolvency turnaround and that group of professionals are expecting a pickup in their engagement in the coming year, especially in the first half of next year. We also have another bit of data that suggests that 4 in 10 manufacturers have or intend to consult with one type of those professionals, whether it be turnaround, insolvency, and so on. And of those that have consulted with those professionals, it's an even split between those that have done so with practical action or those that have done so out of a precautionary measure.
Thank you, James. And the next question, Ross, do we ever foresee a time when there will be no R&D tax relief?
When a lot of what I was talking about today can be seen to be quite negative, where we're seeing a lot of HMRC scrutiny of R&D claims, and I suppose it could lead to people being concerned as to whether they still see the R&D scheme as a viable relief for businesses. I think a lot of what's happening with HMRC activity, I actually think is probably very much the right thing at the moment to make sure that businesses properly understand the R&D scheme and are claiming correctly. I think that over the last few years there has been a fear that there's been a misinterpretation of the rules and the rules might have been applied a bit too leniently. So what is happening with HMRC at the moment, I think, is probably very much the right thing, whilst it might not feel very nice. And if you look at what's happening in the government's direction at the moment, the government's intention is always to support the growth of the UK and UK GDP through innovation and skills and having a high technology industry in the UK. The R&D scheme is something that is very valuable in supporting that, and it's something that isn't unique for the UK. A lot of countries around the world operate some form of R&D scheme, and they do it in order to attract investments into their jurisdiction and to ultimately to grow their GDP by encouraging innovation and IP in their economies. So I can't ever foresee a situation where that would change, and I can't ever see a reason why it wouldn't be one of the tools that government use in order to encourage businesses to innovate, to develop, to skill their workforce, and to make sure that they continue to be at the forefront of their respective markets. So for me, I can't ever see a risk of the scheme being taken away, particularly when you think that we've just had large consultations, and in all of those consultations, it is about making sure that the scheme is fit for purpose and it works correctly for UK business. So in that context, I think it's firmly on the agenda of both the government and HMRC, and it will remain on the agenda and forefront of their tax strategy for years to come.
Brilliant. Thank you, Ross. So that's all the questions we've had today. Thank you again to all the speakers. Really interesting insights from everyone.